professor, now Sir Alfred Ayer, Wicked Professor of Logic at Oxford, and we're very glad that he's joined us, and good afternoon today. And most recently, you've been in the news again. Shall I call you Sir Alfred or Professor Ayer?
Alfred.
Professor Ayer, I think, sounds a little better. Your autobiography called Part of My Life, but I think most people still remember you from television, late 50s, early 60s, The Brain's Trust, right?
Well, yes, I think that's probably when I became best known and most generally recognized, and I did find it enormously enjoyable. We used to meet on Sundays, I think it was, at the beginning, and have a nice lunch at Scott's, just enough to drink to loosen us up, and not so much that we became incoherent. And then had a conversation, and it was totally genuine. A lot of people used to ask me whether it was faked, whether we were told the questions beforehand. But we weren't. We answered spontaneously, and there were usually about five or six of us, and I found it extremely enjoyable. And I must confess, rather enjoyed the notoriety that went with it.
Well,
I was quite pleased when people sort of took double looks at me in the street and sometimes asked me, wasn't I Professor Ayer, and so on. Rather missed it when it stopped.
So there were advantages in being a celebrity?
I think so, that much of a celebrity. I think it would be intolerably such a celebrity that you had people screaming after you wherever you went, to be like a real pop star. But I think if just occasionally someone seems to recognize you and whispers to his neighbor, or actually even asks you for an autograph, or something of this side, kind, it is rather gratifying, I found.
I wonder if that appeals to vanity, because I'd like to quote something that you said and were quoted as saying, and that is that vanity is the sine qua non of philosophers. If so, why?
I don't know why philosophers should be vainer than other persons. I think a good many academics tend to be vain because a good many academics tend to think they don't get the public recognition that they deserve. Here they do such very difficult work and nobody knows much about them. But there are complicated cases in philosophy, because if you're a scientist, you put forward a theory and it gets verified or not, and either you have made a huge discovery or you haven't, and this is something that is testable. Philosophy is a much more complicated in some ways. We're never quite sure that you've got the thing right. I mean, you put up a huge, develop some system, and some other philosopher comes and denies it, and it is very seldom brought to a crucial test in the way that a scientific hypothesis is. So it's not so objective a subject, and in some way more personal a subject, and therefore perhaps one has to blow one's trumpet a little louder to make quite sure that one is as good as one hopes one is.
Or is one whistling in the dark and trying to make the whistle louder defend yourself against the fears that you might be wrong?
It's not so much a matter of being wrong. I don't think people mind so much being wrong. Well, then I got this complicated and not quite right. It's not the fear of being wrong, because I think most of the best philosophers don't all that mind if they are wrong. It is that there aren't any sufficiently clear criteria as whether you are right or wrong. That's what's disturbing. Once it's proved you've got the thing wrong, then that's in a way even almost can sometimes be even encouraging, because then you know perhaps where you've gone wrong, and you know perhaps a new line open up. And you can follow that. It's the state of uncertainty, not knowing whether you're right or wrong, I think, that makes a philosopher unlike other academic people. You get something the same thing in the classics, where there are no very clear criteria in interpreting an ancient text. And certainly classical scholars tend to be very vain indeed, historically. And also very quarrelsome. Philosophers, on the whole, are less quarrelsome. Most quarrelsome people are classical scholars. But why these differences develop, one doesn't always know.
Do you think it's this lack of evident proof that makes the general public, I include myself, feel very remote from philosophers, very wary of philosophers, shall we say?
I think there are lots of reasons. I think the general public, partly through a historical accident, partly because the Stoics, well, the philosophers who became early best known, and as it were gave the general impression of the subject, tend to expect from philosophers things philosophers are not equipped to give. That is, tend to expect some sort of guidance about the ways of life or so on, or tend to expect a philosopher to bear pain more easily than other people, or to be indifferent to misfortunes. Whereas increasingly philosophy has become, like other subjects, fairly technically trying to answer a special set of questions, some of which may interest members of the general public, some of which not. Nobody gets cross with a chemist if he writes books that aren't immediately intelligible to everybody, and the philosopher, I think, is in much the same position. Only he's not expected to be. He's expected to have a message which on the whole now he hasn't.
Well, I think too that we don't expect philosophers to be human, and I'm surprised at other people's surprise that you have human weaknesses, that you love, well, I don't think it's weak to like football, but you love detective stories, you love good food, you love women, you very much love women, of course, that's mentioned in your book. Why do we think the philosophers should be some kind of ascetic tribe apart?
Well, there's no reason in the world why philosophers shouldn't be in this sense human, just as there's no reason in the world why historians shouldn't be, or anybody else who practices any sort of subject. I think this again comes from the Stoics. I think it again comes from the picture of the philosopher put out by, well, Seneca, actually, in Roman times, of the man who is happy on the rack. Also, the idea that philosophy, being an abstract subject, somehow, and also a very absorbing subject, somehow a philosopher is not going to be concerned with more concrete, practical things. But it would be, I mean, no more, no less surprising, in fact, one might rather expect it, to find that a mathematician wasn't altogether human because he was thinking about abstract things all the time. And, I mean, in any given subject, someone who practices the subject, I mean, the people who practice the subject will have widely different personalities. I mean, I can show you philosophers who are, in the sense you've just described, very human, some who are not. But this is very much a matter of their individual personalities, training or environments and so on, than of the subject itself. And this would be equally true of historians. I can show some very human historians, very inhuman ones.
Well, to go back to this particular philosopher in your book, you blithely, buoyantly admit to many affairs with women. Yes. But I can't help getting the feeling that you just love the company of women.
I do like the
chatting
company
with women.
I do like the company of women, yes. I do, always have. Well, always have is not true, because I went to one of those English public schools where one seldom sees a woman. So perhaps I like the company of women all the more. I mean, since I became an adult, having seen so few of them when I was very young, I was an only child and sent away to a private school at the age of 7, and then from there I got a scholarship to Eton and from there to Oxford. So really, until I was almost grown up, I had very little contact with women, except in the holidays. And then my parents didn't have a wide circle of acquaintance. I had a couple of female cousins who were some years younger than myself. So I was brought up in a pretty masculine atmosphere, and happened not to be a homosexual. And therefore, when came in contact with women, I suppose, rushed at them all the more readily because of my long years of deprivation.
But you did have a mother.
Yes, but your mother. Yes, of course. I'm not going to Freudian theory now, which I'm not really expert on. I don't know how Oedipal my relation to my mother was.
Well,
but certainly, if it was Oedipal, the Oedipus part of it was very strongly suppressed.
She seems to have been more of a playmate than a parent in one sense. You talk about the games you enjoyed together.
That very much, yes.
But you also admit, and I think I'm quoting, she would have liked me to be more of what she regarded as a normal boy. She was irritated by your intelligence. Now, that's odd. You'd think she would have been proud of this.
I think it's not so very odd. I think my mother belonged to a very unfortunate generation. She was a very able girl and would have profited by being allowed to go to the university. And she belonged to an age and to a class where it was thought that if you spent money at all, you sent boys to universities, and girls waited at home for someone to marry them. And if they had to be occupied, they had to be sent to art schools, whether they had any aptitude for it or not. And this is what happened to my mother. And I think to some extent, perhaps she may subconsciously have resented the coming out in me and also being fulfilled in me, all the things that she'd been frustrated from doing. And she was also, I mean, highly strung, and I was very highly strung, and in this way we tended to work each other up. And again, I'm looking back at all this from a distance of over 50 years and so on, and I may even have got certain things wrong in this respect. But looking back on it and judge as honestly as I can, I think we were like two children. I think that she had all kinds of qualities that being kept at home and in being treated as a middle-class Edwardian woman had suppressed in her, and these somehow were brought out when she had a fairly bright son to play with, as it were.
But it
and this is what we most enjoyed doing together, was playing. We used to squabble like two children.
It seems to me, of course, that the dominant figure in your young life Well, more than your young life. Was your grandfather?
Throughout my life, yes. He was the most extraordinary person. He was, I don't think you said, but I say in the book that the Dutch side of my family, which was in a sense the stronger side,
the Citroën
side, was Jewish. And you know, generally, Jews insist upon their daughters marrying Jews, and one reason why the Jews have maintained themselves is they have kept this kind of clannishness. My grandfather went just the opposite way. He had worked out that the trouble with the Jews was that they had been too clannish, and that the real solution to the Jewish problem was assimilation. And so he forced his daughters to marry Gentiles, whether they wanted to or not. Just as they had no choice in the matter, they had to marry Gentiles, and I was the product of the first of these Gentile marriages. And then my father, though he a man of great charm, in many ways, wasn't a very successful businessman, and so very soon my grandfather found himself having to maintain the first of his Gentile son-in-law and family. And he was a man of very strong personality, very strong views, and for one reason or another, he was dominant in the family. None of the son-in-laws was able to stand up to him, and he ran our lives. And although he was, as it were, in a sense, out of policy anti-Jewish, he wasn't at least ashamed of being a Jew, let me say this one minute, but I mean in the sense that he thought the Jews ought to assimilate, nevertheless he had this Jewish thing, which is more prominent in America, I believe, than it is here, but it's equally prominent here, of wanting to get on in the world, wanting to get the family to get established, wanting the family to, what is the American phrase, to make it. Mm-hmm. And since I was the eldest grandchild, a lot of this pressure fell on me, and so I did from a kind of competitiveness, which probably was there in me anyway, genetically, was very much developed by him. And perhaps in this way, he didn't do me so much good, because I think that certainly in my youth, and possibly even now, I was over-competitive. On the other hand, he also opened up a lot of worlds to me intellectually. He talked to me from quite a young age, very liberally, as though I was an adult, and gave me books to read that I wouldn't otherwise have read, and encouraged me to think independently. And I think I owe an enormous amount to him, more to him than to any other single person.
Do you think he would have been very proud of the course your life has taken?
I think so. I think that he did value ordinary material success, and quite often when I get a gong of some sort, someone gives me an honorary degree or whatever, I do think I don't believe in an afterlife. I don't believe, and I said, what a pity there isn't an afterlife, because I really would like Grandpa to see me now. I mean, he had great love for me. I had great love for him, and. I do sometimes think, well, it is a pity that I can't believe in afterlife, mainly for this reason, because what pleasure it would have given him.
Can we return to the book for a moment? You say at one point, talking about your first wife, you say mm-hmm. she had a deeper nature than I. Now, I don't know what that implies. Does that imply that you have a shallow nature, or that she was a woman of peculiar passion, or what?
It implies that I have a shallow nature relatively to her, certainly. What I think I meant it to imply was that I was and am more volatile, that I live much more easily in the moment, that once something has gone wrong, and then the breakdown of our first marriage was, I haven't gone into it in detail in the book, because first of all, my first wife is still alive, and secondly, it's not something I want to proclaim abroad, but I mean, there are some circumstances about the breakdown of our first marriage that were very, very painful indeed, and I suffered a very great deal. And, but I can live in the moment. I mean, I can put things like this behind me and go on to something new quicker than most other people. In this way, I think I am, if you like, more volatile is perhaps a better word than shallower. Whereas in the case of my first wife, I mean, I think that any emotion that she feels very deeply, very strongly and
lastingly.
Lastingly, yes.
No. There was an 18.
She also, next to my grandfather, had an enormous influence on me. The first person, perhaps, ever showed me love, because my grandfather was too Olympian. I admired him, but he was also. Men, anyhow, find it harder to express their feelings. At school, I would always embroil everyone. This was. Everything, suddenly, new worlds opened at the age of, what was it, 18, when I first fell in love with my friend Rene, whom I then married when I left Oxford. And it's. I'm still sorry that it broke down, but still, that's something that I don't think in autobiography one is absolutely obliged, you know, to
confess all.
To confess all. I don't think one has to imitate Rousseau.
I think perhaps
particularly if as Rousseau one actually falsifies.
Well, I was going to bring that up. I think that the critics are a little puzzled that there's so little apparent pain, anguish, uncertainty in your autobiography. Of course, it only covers 35 years.
Yes.
We must remember
yes.
that. But I was surprised to hear you say that you did suffer, but that does not come through in the book. Can I ask you if there's a double meaning in the title, part of my life, literally, just the first 35 years, and also part of my life, I will not confess all?
There is a double meaning, certainly. Both, yes, in exactly the way you've described. But I don't think that it was a matter of wishing to show myself as indifferent to things to which I wasn't. Obviously, I'm not going to confess everything. Anyhow, nobody can confess all, because then it becomes like Tristram Shandy. You never get the book finished. If you have to put down everything that happens every day, the thing goes on to eternity. One has to select. And I left out things that seemed to me to be pointless, or things that I couldn't make interesting, or things that weren't amusing. But I didn't wish to suppress expressions of feeling, and I thought I had put them in, but I put them in the only way I know how. I mean, this is a new form of writing for me. Up to now, I've always written about philosophy, and written about philosophy in a very spare fashion, always try to pare everything down to the essentials of an argument. Now, this is a totally new way of writing for me, and when I wanted to express feelings, I did so in something the same way. I mean, I did say, and I hoped by this touch or that touch to make it clear that in some cases they were quite deep and acute, but I didn't know how to expatiate. I didn't know how to develop it. I didn't know how to put the colour in, if you like. And it may be a criticism of the book that it is written too much like a philosophy book.
The word that seems to emerge, or I haven't fed this into a computer, in the book is clever, usually about you. I mentioned that Einstein called you that clever young man. E. E. Cummings said to your second wife, how can you be involved with that stainless steel mind? The very quality of cleverness doesn't imply maturity or wisdom, does it?
Oh, no, by no means.
Where would you put yourself in that scale? Shall we say 90 out of 100 for cleverness?
Oh, it's awfully difficult. How does one measure?
Well, you're the philosopher. How does one measure?
Cleverness. I think I am clever, yes. I'm not sure that cleverness always matters so much in philosophy. In fact, sometimes it's been held to be detrimental to me, in the sense that it stops you going into things perhaps quite as deeply as you should. But I think, obviously I'm older now and slowing up a bit, but certainly at one time I was very quick and got points quickly, and new ideas came to me. In that way, I think cleverness is justified. Wise, I don't know. I don't think I've would count myself on the whole a wise man. I think that I'm often very rash. I often jump into things. I've got a sense of excitement. I've got a sense of that, like I said earlier, living in the moment, which is on the whole slightly incompatible, I think, with wisdom. I think of a wise man more as someone who surveys things perhaps at any given moment over a wider range than I do, and judges them a little more dispassionately. He doesn't see this lovely object and jump for it to the extent that I do. So I wouldn't put myself down as a wholly wise man. What was the third thing you asked me?
Well,
clever, wise, and...
And mature. You're 67
mature, 66.
66. Are you mature?
I'll
give you back the 12 months.
Mature. Well, here again, I think I have matured in the sense that I think I less vulnerable than I was. I'm not sure that maturing is always a good thing. I think maturing often means that you become indifferent to things that once moved you, and that perhaps goes with being less easily attracted by things that once excited you. I'm not sure that I attach such a great importance to maturity. If I've matured at all, I hope it would be in the way of taking a little more thought about the effects of my actions upon other people. I think there was a time when I rushed ahead, clutching at this, clutching at that, not worrying whom I was hurting. If I've matured at all, I should hope it would be that now I would hesitate and think, well, now no, this is really not, it's really is going to damage someone, I won't do it. And
Sir Alfred, I'm afraid our time has gone. Thank you very much for being our guest today.
least hard in the sense of hostile. No, on the contrary. No, but I really feel that.